I'm Sutinder Khehar. I was born in Kenya, but my dad used to work for the British police, the British government recruiting from India. And so he worked for the British, and eventually when Kenya got independence, the only country left to come back was Britain. And I was on the verge of playing hockey at an international level at the age of 17 when my family just left. So luckily I didn't play international hockey from Kenya, otherwise that would have been the end of my career. Because if you played for one country in those days, you couldn't play for another country. So I was about 2 months away from playing an international hockey in Kenya. And when I came to England, completely different environment. I used to play in plimsolls, bloody cold. But I loved the game, and within a month joined Slough Hockey Club. And within 1 year, started playing hockey for Britain, England. So lucky break for me. And lasted a long time. I played interest hockey for about 10 years. In those days, we only played about 5 or 6 interactions a year. These days, you play that in a month. And so I played 80 times for England and Great Britain, indoor, outdoor.
Indoor and outdoor?
Yeah.
Tell me a bit about the indoor.
Indoor was something that was a bit of fun hockey. I used it for training. And because I'm a fairly slim guy, a lot of skill, indoor hockey was a piece of cake. Yeah. It's warm, it's easy, but it was primarily for my outdoor hockey.
So you preferred outdoor hockey?
I prefer outdoor hockey, yeah.
What surfaces were you playing on?
Grass. Most of my hockey was in grass. In fact, I think only my last 2 years of my international career was on AstroTurf pitch. And that was in Ascender World Hockey Tournament in Perth, Australia. That would be 1978.
So tell me about your first international.
My first international was, wow, gosh. It was against, I think, Belgium. Such a long time ago, I can't really remember.
Can you remember hearing that you'd been selected?
Yes, it was a bit of a shock that I so quickly made it from one country to another. And I remember my first cap, I wasn't working, I was a student then, and my dad had just got a job, and he said, they've selected me, but I need to buy a tie, I need to buy a badge, I need to buy the socks. In those days, an amateur game, and I need £5. And so in those days, a lot of money. So obviously my dad was delighted, someone find £5 to buy all that. And of course, in those days, they gave you a badge, but you had to go and buy a blazer.
Yes.
Yeah, so my mom sewed it on, so it was great. My dad understood hockey very well. He played in his own time. Yes.
So you played against Belgium?
Yep.
And was that a good debut?
I played centre half. I've always played centre half. I was competent, and I think from there I knew I was comfortable at that level, so I was going to last quite a long time, as long as I didn't upset anybody.
But I remember you scoring goals as well.
For my club, I scored a lot of goals. Yeah. Because for my club, I defend short corners, I take short corners. For England, we are the specialists. So basically in midfield, you're rather more busy doing other things than scoring goals.
So who were the players you had most affinity with in the England team?
My first tournament, I think, was in Spain, the European Cup in Spain, Madrid. And Mike Corby was a big kingpin in those days, and he was a squash player, he was everything. And he had his own style of playing. So we'd have a team talk, go onto the pitch, get together and say, that forget everything what the coach said. This is what we're going to do. Get the ball, give it to me. And that's all I ever did. Stop the ball, give it to him, because he's a great player. And he loved playing with me, because the minute I got the ball, it was on his stick. Yeah. So my career was going to last a long time, as long as he was playing, because I was the first person to give him the ball.
But your career, I think, lasted in England longer than his.
Yes, I mean, I remember when in Madrid when he played, he was an older and I was an 18-year-old and he was probably a 30-year-old who had come back. But we did very well. We finished bronze. We won. And I think the European Cup was about 20 countries. It's a lot of countries. Yes. So we had a bronze medal in Madrid, 73, I think.
So when Mike stopped playing and you had other forwards...
Then, of course, Bernie Cotton became the captain. David Whittaker was the left half, I was the centre half. Norman Hughes was there. So those were my colleagues and people we ran and trained together.
Did you develop the same sort of close partnership with any of the other forwards as you had with Mike Corby?
No, my style was very different. My style was attacking hockey. Yes. Bernie Cotton, they were passively defenders, man-to-man mark. In those days, you know, all you had to do is stand behind somebody, get obstruction. Mine was intercept, get in front, and counter-attack. So my style was 100% opposite to there. But we fitted in together.
And looking back on your fairly lengthy career, what were the standout moments for you?
World Cup in Bombay, 1982. I announced my retirement, so they made me the captain in the last game. Which we was against Malaysia. We beat Malaysia and finished sixth. And I remember we seemed to be about sixth in the world. And on par, we finished sixth. And then I thought, wow, for 20 years, we have always finished sixth. So, you know, the new teams now, they've gone up to three or four. But for years and years, I thought, we're as good as any team for the next 20 years. Because no British team or English team did better than sixth. So I've always finished sixth in the two World Cups that I played in.
But you got a bronze medal in the...
In the European Cup in Madrid. And then I got selected, Roger Self came in. And I remember Roger put me on the line once. We had a Friday training weekend at Crystal Palace. And from Slough, it's a two-hour drive. 7 o'clock, turn up. Roger standing down there, right, around the Crystal Palace track, 3 miles. Then we go under those very dodgy lights. And he said, Khehar, you think you got a good eye? I said, yeah. Go and stand on the line. Then I was on one line, Paul Barber on the other, Ian Taylor. Ian Taylor's obviously all dressed up. I had a little chin patch and an 18-ounce stick. And he got the whole squad to run in and take shots. And I thought, the law of average says that the best guys in the country are hitting 120 balls, one's going to hit you on the head. But I was fairly confident, I had a good eye. And I was standing on the thing. And he said, Khehar, are you scared on the line? I said, no, these guys can't hit the ball. And Bernie Cotton would come and undercut the ball and missed by an inch here, missed by an inch there. I stood there for 45 minutes on the line, ducking and diving, but I wasn't going to let anybody score. So I thought, wow, yeah. After that, I thought, yeah, I deserve to get on a plane because this is putting your life on the line against the best in the country. And there's, you know, they wear masks now, they got everything. 18-ounce stick and I was cracking it away. That was my job. If I'm standing on the line, that's what I'm doing. Yeah.
And the friendships that you've made with people along the way?
Wonderful, and they're still my friends. What people don't realize is sometimes people think, oh, you're playing against India, you're Indian. I've trained with guys in the snow, I've run up. We have gone up and down the hill and vomited together. In the end, when you get on a pitch, it's the 11 guys with you that you have to depend on, and they depend on you. So we have become great friends. And remember, we're all amateurs. Monday, I had to go back to work, and nobody gave a damn where you come from or where you've been, as long as you clocked in at 8 o'clock. So in those days, nobody gave you time off for hockey.
Would you like to be playing now with the current rules?
I still play. I'm 63 now. And I've not lost over 60 games in the last 3 years. I play for Indian Gymkhana and we are the England over 60 champions, 3 years on the trot. So I'm still fit and strong.
Wonderful to hear, long may it continue. Thank you very much indeed
Thank you.
For talking to me.